You know, we look forward to your interaction. It is intended to be interactive. There are some questions and answers. There's a question and answer format. And there is a panel discussion at the end. And we urge you, I believe, Mr. Roberts, to do a very good job to ensure that you don't end up with 100 people in the room to the target, but you don't end up with 100 feature addresses. So I know he's going to manage that. So, ladies and gentlemen, we look forward to an absolutely insightful day, and I thank you all for taking the time to come, and we look forward. It's all about sport. Keep an open mind, because it is going to be thought-provoking. At the end of the day, let us all contribute to working to be transformative. So thank you very much, and enjoy.
We would now like to invite the first speaker, Mr. Edwin Turret, President of the National Association of Athletics Administration of Trinidad and Tobago, the NTAAs.
Pleasant good morning, President of the Trinidad and Tobago Olympic Committee, Mr. Brian Lewis, Mr. Huey Cadet, Secretary for the Division of Youth, Sport and Education, Tobago Observer Assembly, Mr. Isley Crawford, TC, first Olympic gold medalist, Dr. Keith Clifford, Chair of the First Citizens Foundation, other distinguished ladies and gentlemen. When Mr. Lewis approached me to do this presentation, I had to give it great thought. And he indicated just now that he was just supposed to do a welcome. So I think in doing the welcome, he did address some of the areas that I'm supposed to be addressing. So it makes it very easy for me. So I think I can go back to my seat. He has asked me to look at influencing the sport industry through policy. And I know most of you, you know, think that for me, as I had over the carnival season, I did some broadcast interviews, commentary on Steel Pan, and people like Mr. Serrat and Steel Pan. I know some people this morning probably wondering, what is he doing here as well? I have spent some 33 years in the public sector. I know most people feel that being president of the NTAAs is my job. It's not. I do not get paid for that. It's give back to Trinidad and Tobago for what it has done for me. I benefited from a national sports award back in the day, and I have decided to give back, and this is what I'm doing today. Over the last couple of years. So when he approached me, I said, I give it some thought, and I think it's something that we really need to look at because sport continues to be looked at as recreational and pastime. We have not understood in this part of the region the importance of sport and what sport can do. So I took the view, and I look, the way I looked at this presentation, I was looking at the impact that sport can play with respect to in Trinidad and Tobago. Oftentimes, when I get into the presentation, you'll see when I look at the socio-economic impact in Trinidad and Tobago, we tend to look at just the social aspect of sport. So when we look at our national development plans, be it 2020, 2030, whatever it is, sport is factored under the social aspect. We don't ever pay attention to the economic aspect of sport. So my presentation format, I would look at the importance of sport to a nation. I would try to look at some of the performance of Trinidad and Tobago in sport, the socio-economic impact of sport, sport governance, sport infrastructure, sport equipment and apparel, competitions, sport as a career. The time allotted is not really going to give me the opportunity to do justice to all areas, but I will just speak very briefly in some of the areas. You would have heard Mr. Lewis indicated that globally, the sports sector is estimated to be worth between US $500 to $600 billion and contributes to about 1.5% GDP as of various countries. How does this relate to Trinidad and Tobago? In Trinidad and Tobago, sport is yet to be recognized as a sector or as an industry. Over the past 2 weeks, I've been searching for data that could give me a sense of where we are, and that has proven to be very difficult. There are a few studies. There was just one study done by the National Trade Agency on the labor market on the sport industry. But there has been no real studies with respect to the contribution sport can do. Also, in doing this research, sector comes up to be very ambiguous. It's an ambiguous term, and it varies from country to country, jurisdiction to jurisdiction. So, I took this definition from the West Virginia University, which defines the sports industry as one of that consists of several different segments, including sport tourism, sports goods, as retail, the manufacturing, professional amateur sports, the national governing bodies, and some other areas as well. When we look at the performance of Trinidad and Tobago sport, Olympic and non-Olympic, sometimes I wonder, depending on the part of Trinidad and Tobago you are, if you ask what's the national sport of Trinidad and Tobago, you could get a different answer. And so we have cricket, very popular. We have football, which is very popular. We have athletics, track and field. We have volleyball. Cricket, not being an Olympic sport, but it continues to have varying success regionally. Cricket in the region is more regional, so we have the West Indies cricket team. The Trinidad and Tobago team would have performed at the IPL as a national team, and they had great success there. But it varies from time to time. They were successful this year in the regional tournament, the 50 overs. Football too, varying successes back in the 70s, the World Cup disqualifying, losing to Haiti in 2006. They have qualified for the World Cup. Track and field, one of the areas or the sports that continues to be consistent on the international. And some people may feel I'm being biased, being the president of the Athletic Federation. Hockey, volleyball, and others. But I say that because when we look at the Olympic sports, Trinidad and Tobago has 16 Olympic medals, or 18 that is. And track and field is responsible for 14 of those 18 medals. The president indicated to us now, and we saw that in the video, that there's this goal or this vision for 10 gold medals by 2024. And for some reason, in Trinidad and Tobago, we set goals, and he indicated that what we are very good at defining the issues, the problems. 10 goals by 2024 is a very good vision, but we now have to develop a theoretical or contextual framework to achieving that. Because very often in Trinidad and Tobago, we look at the output. And I want to say to the 10 goals by 2024, yes, we will attract corporate Trinidad and Tobago to support, to be funding athletes, to be preparing for this. But no amount of funding can buy an Olympic gold medal. So we have to develop this contextual framework. How are we going to achieve this? So we can't just be depending on looking at funding to prepare athletes. The athletes, everybody involved, must be part of this and has to be at the table and understanding where we're going. When we look at the socio-economic impact of sport, sport can make a significant difference to the socio-economic impact on a nation and its citizens. It plays a very important role in ensuring physical fitness, healthy lifestyles, unites people from diverse backgrounds that we know well. Back in 76, Olympic gold medalists in Scotland, we had Tokyo in 2006. Everyone forget whatever troubles we had in Trinidad and Tobago. In 2012, Keyshawn Walcott's gold medal. And this is where I'm saying that in all of our national development plans, sports tend to factor only on the social aspect of it, not looking at the economic contributions. So that if you look at all the national development programs, they address sports, the healthy lifestyles, wellness, and all these different areas. And even when they do that, looking at data, there is no data saying as to when the interventions happen, where they are, and after the intervention, what has changed, which is another area that we don't do too well in Trinidad and Tobago. We tend not to understand the difference between output, outcome, what is the result. If I'm to use an example of the water taxi, say, we see reports of the water taxis transporting some thousands of people each week from San Fernando to Port of Spain, and we celebrate that. We say that's a success. Is that really a success? What was the problem initially? If we had to think about it, the problem was to alleviate traffic coming from San Fernando. Has that been solved? We don't. But those are the things that we miss. Those are the things that we miss. We tend to focus on the output. So back in when we had the under 17 tournament, we had the state level, Larry Gomes, Larry Bill. But what was the intention for these facilities after? Most of the time they may be in the planning stages, but they don't follow through. So we end up with all these facilities and we don't have plans for the future. Just had this to support the point where sport is a driver of economic development and has significant bearing on tourism, lifestyles, public health, and ultimately a country's international reputation. It also plays an important role in the growth and appeal of any country. And again, this is where in our national development plans we focus on just these areas, on tourism, we talk about lifestyles, public health, and when I say tourism, sport tourism, and these things, when we look at these, we pay lip service to most of these things, sport tourism. What do we understand by sport tourism? We say this because it's the key buzzword internationally. Diversification is nothing new. We've been speaking about diversification since back in the 60s, but we continue to depend on oil and gas and not understand the areas that we can look to really contribute to the economy. I had to go elsewhere to look for data, so I was looking at a case study in England back in 2010. In used to analyze the communities. It also supported approximately 400,000 full-time equivalent jobs, equating to 2.3% of all the jobs in the country. And these are the things that we need to be looking at. But we focus on social aspect. So we have, when you look at the social aspect here, participating in sports, we need to curb crime and the social behavior, leading to improved health and education standards. But when we say improved health, what do we understand by improved health? What was the situation before the intervention? I keep, going back to that point, we tend not to look at what was and where we want to go. How are we getting there? It also encouraged volunteering, which had an estimated economic value of the sport related to volunteering about £2.3 billion. So that we tend, as I would say, we hear me say this over and over, we tend to focus on the social aspect. The social aspect, and in all the things we do in Trinidad and Tobago, we still do not develop the contextual framework for whatever intervention that we are looking at. We understand, as the president of the Olympic Committee indicated, we understand all the issues. Where do we want to go? How do we get there? And those are the things that we kind of chart. We may be able to chart up to the output aspect, so we know what are the resources, we would know what activities need to be done, and we would know, based on the activities, what output we will get. But what is the change that we want to bring about? How do we measure those things? Sports governance. When I look at sports governance structure in Trinidad and Tobago is not properly defined. If we were to look at the Olympic Charter of what it is. In Trinidad and Tobago, we have various sporting organizations, varying structures. The Olympic Committee in itself, I know they have been doing enough, a lot of work to try to bring some structure to this. Respect to development training, we have the Ministry of Sport and Youth Affairs. It's really supposed to be facilitating the national sporting organizations, but sometimes gets itself involved in promotions as well as the development. We have the Sport DT, which also is an arm of the ministry. The Ministry of Education, we have sport in schools. Sure if education communicates with sport. So we have sport in schools, how does that work? Sports in school, Ministry of Sport, what kind of collaboration takes place with respect to the sport in the schools, whether the teachers who are involved are being trained through sport and assigned to schools as to refer to Jamaica. Jamaica has a GC Foster College, which turns out coaches that goes into the school system. And we always want to know why Jamaica doing so well, why we not doing so well. But there's a system there. They're producing coaches to go into the system, to the schools. We have physical education teachers. Just yesterday, I visited the stadium. I think there was Central Port of Spain Primary School Sports. And the entire main stand was filled. The entire main stand. So that meant that the principals brought out all the children. And that's a Central Port of Spain. When we have the National Primary School Championships, the main stand cannot be filled. And that worries me. Why just a central, just a few schools? So that we have few people understanding what the sport can, what sport can do. We also have measure community development and culture, and I can add Ministry of Social Development in this as well. And when we look at the structure, if there's a structure, if we have a proper structure, then we would not be in a space where organizations can go to Ministry of Sport, get funding for a particular event. They can go to community development and get funding for that same event. And they can also go to social development and get funding for the same event. And neither venture sport, venture community development, or social development will have any idea. And we have very clever people in Trinidad and Tobago who have coined their proposals as a community project, and they can have crime in the area, so that they would do that, they go to sport and they get funded. And they go to another ministry and get funded for the same event. And there's no way that we can pick up that this is a project or program that is being funded three times. There's no way we can get that up. So we need to have some sort of structure when we look at the whole governance issue. If I can speak with track and field, for the past 3 years, we have been going through a reform initiative. And I'm proud to say that understanding sport as a business, track and field is now moving in a direction where it would be governed by a board of directors with term limits, and you know, operating as a business, because we have been incorporated under the Companies Act of 2008. And this is a direction that all the other sporting organizations need to adopt. And you know, we have also moved to a 4-year term, because in various sporting organizations, some have 1-year terms, some have 2 years, some have 3 years, and that does not bode well for development and you know, continuities of initiatives that will be set up by the administrators previously. So that those are some of the things, the governance structures that we need to address. These areas, I will just touch briefly on it. Sports infrastructure. We know when I say sport infrastructure, we have the cycling velodrome, the aquatic center, the tennis center. So all of these contribute to the economy. So we have employment with the infrastructure, the facilities. Cycling velodrome, as I understand, is the oldest one of its type in the hemisphere, the region, so that you can now have international competitions. So there we talk sport tourism. But I'm not too sure whether in the contextual framework, whether all these things will be taught out. As far as I see, Trinidad and Tobago is missing a very great opportunity with the Olympics in Rio. We should have had teams coming to Trinidad and Tobago to camp, and with the easy route, I think we have flights out to Tobago with direct to Rio, and that in itself would have been contributing to the economy. And as I go on to my point, what is the whole contextual framework developed for that? We have the velodrome, the aquatic center, the Atobolan Stadium. Where is the accommodation? The Hyatt. I know for a fact that the Americans were here looking at, you know, thinking about using the aquatic center, and they did some simulation, so they would have left the Hyatt to go to Coover for 6 o'clock for their training. They were estimated that their training would be 2 hours, so they're leaving at the Coover at 8 o'clock. What would have happened to them coming back on the road at 8 o'clock? Traffic. So these are the things that we need to, when we doing these projects, we need to think out the entire thing, not just to the output. And we celebrate, and that's one of the things that bothers me. We celebrate the buildings. So we have a big opening, cut ribbon, everybody says, yes, building completed. What next? What is going to change? Because, and those are the things we need to look at. The aquatic center, All these facilities that we develop. Sports equipment and apparel. We have numerous companies in Trinidad and Tobago who are supplying these. Some of them are even being done here. And again, contributing to the economy. Competitions is another area. We have CPL, as I indicated. A lot of potential for a lot of international and regional competitions to be held here. sport as a career. I did something recently on this, and I think some people misinterpreted what I was trying to say. When we look at sport as a career, when we look at people like Brian Lara, Dwight York, Pollard, can name a number of others, they are one in a million. But when we look at the amount of money that sportsmen are making, it comes back into the economy because they come home, they build houses, they buy purchase vehicles and all that, so it comes back into the economy. We tend not to take sport as a career seriously, and it's not just the participating, we have sports therapy, sports lawyers, all the different areas where sport is concerned. And we tend not to focus on that because our society is one that focus on lawyers, doctors, and not on this other areas people can get into. That could be, you know, a potential to do well in the country. Right now, we are always struggling for sports therapists, different areas, sports lawyers. Even when we were doing our constitution, we had to look far and wide in order to get somebody to assist the federation with respect to developing this new constitution. So, in concluding, as the president indicated, the conversation now needs to take place on a national policy and the direction for sport as a viable sector or industry, more now than ever. When we look at what's happening with oil and gas, as I indicated, diversification is not new. I've been hearing about diversification way back in the 60s. We speak about diversification, but we just pay lip service because we continue to benefit from oil and gas and think that we don't need to look at any other areas for that could contribute to our economy. And with this, I want to thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Officer, President of Entries. Now I'd like to invite our keynote speaker for today, Kevin Roberts, an overview of a global sport industry, country and to be able to compete to succeed.
Good morning, everybody. How are you? Very nice to see you. When I first had a telephone call with a conversation with Brian Lewis about an event he was organising, I came away with the impression that it would probably be a little gathering around the boardroom table somewhere. So this is quite a remarkable turnout. And I guess it's a remarkable turnout because every one of you is so aware of the importance of this conversation. I guess also a lot of you are aware that there are big challenges ahead, big challenges to try and unlock the business potential, which lies somewhere at the heart of sport in Trinidad and Tobago. And as I was traveling over for here, I picked up a book that somebody had sent me last year sometime, and I'd only read the first couple of pages. It's called Star Spangled Soccer by a guy called Gary Hopkins, who is a British guy, although he's lived in Wales for the last 30 years or so, sports commentary city. And he was part of the solving of one of the biggest problems, and I think possibly one of the biggest achievements in retrospect in the history of sport and sports marketing, which was how you make soccer popular in the United States, in the world's most significant, the world's most advanced and sophisticated sports market, a world in which you already have powerhouse leagues in American football in baseball, in hockey. Where was the room? How do you make the room for a sport which was played by the wimpy kids who couldn't get into the football team, weren't tall enough to play basketball? How do you find room for a sport that was played by Hispanics and Europeans who haven't quite given up on their heritage and become proper Americans? Where do you find room for a sport which was described by one commentator in the serious, I mean the serious, US press as a sport for communists? That, seriously, that is what they were up against. And that was only 30 years ago. That must have seemed like an insurmountable problem. Fast forward to 2016. The United States has an international soccer team, both in men's and women's, which sit way up the FIFA ranking, and of course, particularly the US women's side. They staged in 1994 one of the most financially successful World Cups in the history of the World Cup. And now, Major League Soccer, which had its ups and downs, has taken wing. They're playing to packed houses in Seattle. There's a new team in last season joined the fray in New York. The Los Angeles Galaxy have become a global brand in their own right, and all in the space of a generation and a half. So when you sit and wrestle with your own difficulties about what to do in Trinidad and Tobago, I'm not suggesting that the scale is similar, but the aspiration has to be. There's a problem there, and with creativity, with determination, by thinking outside the box and harnessing the appeal of sport to the power of corporations, by creating a link and allowing the corporate world to see that it's not just about patronage, it's not just about emptying your pockets to try and support, it's about making an investment that will produce real business and social benefits, then it's possible to achieve whatever objectives you set for yourself. Now, before I really get going, yeah, don't worry, I haven't quite finished yet. Perhaps you're pleased that I'm going to have to try multitask now, which is not something that I'm particularly noted for. I'm going to be able to work this machine and talk to you at the same time. So here goes. I might need some help here. Let's go. Yes. Okay. Okay, before I get on with the business, I would like just to formally thank Brian Lewis and the Trinidad and Tobago Olympic Committee for their invitation to join you here today. I spent some time with Monday on my arrival, touring some of the facilities, including the new velodrome and the aquatic centre, and supposedly I do agree with all of your observations as far as that's concerned, but they are fantastic world-class facilities which give you a huge amount of potential. So there is reason to be cheerful in all of this. I told you this might take a little bit of time to get... As you see on mine, it just works if you touch the touch. Okay. There we go. Anybody recognize any of those guys? Either of those guys? It's got to be handy. There's a hand. Does somebody actually recognize one of those guys? Go on, give us a name. Wilfred Zaha. And the other one? Absolutely. Now, okay. I'm a middle-aged, balding, married man with children. I love those guys. I love those guys because, not so much just recently, but they light up my Saturday afternoons. I go and watch Crystal Palace play football in, for this season, at least the English Premier League. Maybe not next season, the way things are going. So, it's a love affair. And the reason my professional reason, everything else goes out of the window between 3 o'clock and 5 o'clock on those Saturday afternoons when the guys are in action. I love seeing these two tearing into the opposition with their tricks, their trickery, putting people on the ground, going, triumphing. We don't actually score, but they do. Really, it makes it, you know, scarcity is a good thing. But the point is, it's about the relationship. It's a love thing. I love those guys. They may not be playing for us next year. I love the club. I love football. And it's a different kind of relationship to that which I have with most everything else in my life. It's certainly different from the kind of relationship that I have with any consumer product. With a beer, which I'm a bit partial to, who cares really what brand? It's not a love thing, it's just a beer. With a piece of television technology, it's not a love thing, it's just a piece of television technology. The sport is different. The sport, it's about love, it's about passion, it's about connecting in new ways. So, and if you're in the business of sport, this is the great advantage that you start with. You're selling aspirations, you're selling dreams, you're selling engagement. You've got all this working for you. It's one of the most exciting industries in the world. But I need to try and put some sort of perspective on this, because there's one question which keeps coming up. How do you go from the love thing to a money thing? And I'd just like to introduce you to two other guys. Let's see if you recognize these guys. And yet again, There's a slight delay. I thought it was just jet lag. Okay. Do we recognize those guys now? Okay. On the left, Mark McCormack, the founder of IMG, the man who, legend has it, formed a sports marketing empire on a handshake with Jack Nicklaus, a man who got the love thing, who knew how to translate the power of sport, the connectivity of sport, the ability to engage with consumers into business. A talented guy who I once met, and he explained that the reason he wasn't into soccer was because there wasn't any money in it. Mm-hmm. He went a little bit too early, I think. Now, and on the right, you know who that is? Rupert Murdoch. How can you look that miserable when you've just married Jerry Ball? Almost impossible when you have that much money. But Murdoch as well, as a media baron. Murdoch's investment in sport has been a game changer. Not everybody would say that it's changed the game for the better, but certainly it is changing. Murdoch realized the power of sport, the passion for sport, the love for sport would be the engine to drive his paid television services in the UK, in the USA, in Australia, and elsewhere around the world. These two guys have been among the prime agents of change in the sport business. So, some context. It's about love. It's about business acumen, taking the love and making it into a business. And the question that we always get asked is, how big a business is this really? So I'm going to hit with some figures. In fact, that's a question. It's a bit like those great questions that, like, do you know the way to San Jose in the song? It's never really answered. Still waiting. I first heard that song when I was 5 years old. I still don't know the way to San Jose on the back of it. What's the other one that we never get a proper answer for? Oh, yeah. Is that good for you? All right. Now, sorry to let you into my life in quite that way. So, on that basis, let's have a look at some of the figures about the size of the business of sport. Here we go. If it works like it did before, there will be a slight pause, and here we are. Right, about 15 years ago, I spent some time with an American guy. He does some stuff on CBS called Rick Horrow. He's written books about the sports industry. And I said, how much is it worth, Rick? And he answered, we're doing something a bit like this. I said, it's $1 trillion at least. It was only 2 weeks later that I realized that Rick had just written a book called The $1 trillion Game, and that was the biggest plug he could possibly get. So he had his reasons for inflation, one day or another. perhaps more reliably and kind of in the range that Brian Smithers came from for AT Kearney, about $700 billion, one tenth of global GDP is attributable in some way to sport. And the reason that the figures vary so widely is that what do you put in? Do you put in the value of the real estate around the world for every golf course? Is that part of it? And how much is it worth tomorrow, today, as opposed to what it was worth yesterday in a fluctuating market? It's a complex equation, so we just take out of it was huge. 9.8 billion for total revenue generated by Europe's big five soccer leagues. So that's the Bundesliga in Germany, Ligue 1 in France, the English Premier League, Serie A in Italy, and La Liga in Spain. $9.8 billion. It sounds absolutely huge, but here's a bit of perspective. That's the biggest five football leagues in the world, $9.8 billion. The single year turnover for Tesco, a British supermarket, was $119 billion in their last figures. Emirates, an airline, had turnover of something in the region of $50 billion plus. And certainly a major car manufacturer like BMW is way up into the $198-200 billion. So just a little bit of perspective about where sport is as a business. It's big. Is it huge by comparison to other things? It's not as big. That turnover of five leagues isn't as big as one single airline. The NFL, their TV rights, they've just done a renewal that takes them up to 2022. It went up 60%, adding $26 billion to that, and that is almost entirely from the US market. So a huge figure. English Premier League rights, a slightly different kind of situation. The new deals are worth together about $12 billion. And the interesting thing there is that it's almost equal now between the domestic market and the overseas market. And that in itself, the effective colonialization of domestic sports is an issue that the rest of the world is having to face up to. Global sponsorship, according to IEG, is worth $55 billion and rising. And as we see people's attention switching from television and internet advertising to finding new ways of supporting that through a different kind of engagement, sponsorship across the board, whether it's sports, which is still predominantly 80% of revenue driven sponsorship goes from sports, that will continue to rise. And here's the thing. Super Bowl advertising, you've got $5 million, you can buy a single spot to advertise during Super Bowl. And all those big figures may, at the end of the day, they're just big figures. It's more than any of us earn. It's probably worth more than any of the companies that we've met. It's just the hugeness of it. It's been so huge that it's come almost impersonal. And I can put things in here, it's big, why is this relevant to our discussion? Relevant because it speaks to the power. It speaks to the power of sport, and it's relevant because it tells you that if you can find a way of harnessing that power, scaling it, you can scale it down to find opportunities to make the business of sport work for you. Let's try one more of these. Okay, some more things. I'll just stay here because I'm going to skip through these. And again, it just makes the point. This is huge. Look at Europe's Football League. Real Madrid, a single football club generating over $500 million a year. They're soon to be replaced in this league because of what we just put through. The new television deal in England. When this survey going to Europe is done the next time, Manchester United are likely to be top because of that extra television income. You see, these are huge sums of money driven by sport, by football clubs which themselves employ thousands of people on match days and hundreds of people outside of match days. Match days are a money fest. If you're a fan from the moment you leave home to the moment you get back again, there are opportunities to engage in in trade, so engage in transactions one way or another around your experience of sport. It is huge, and it's getting huger. And as a result of those sort of revenues, the clubs themselves are achieving incredible levels of value. Real Madrid are, according to Forbes, the most valuable team in the world, with a value of 3.26 billion. But it's not just European football. The Cowboys in the NFL, one of the best recognized brands in world sport, are right up there at number two. The Yankees in baseball, Barcelona, Manchester United, and even the Lakers in the NBA really don't quite have that that global position, I would suggest, as the others, have become hugely valuable and investable. There is always a queue when an American sports franchise or a leading European sports franchise becomes available for sale. There are always a queue of investors waiting to make sure that they can get a piece of this action. So valuable properties create in their life cycle more value. And what are the trends that are driving all this? Let's just take a couple of minutes to look at it. It's main revenue rights at this level of global sport come from media, from sponsorship, and from what these big clubs, whatever the sport, these big organizations can make on a match day. What this is doing is creating a trend of polarization between the big valuable events and the rest. Money has been hoovered up by soccer generally. It's been hoovered up by the NFL and other major US sports. It's starting to have an impact now in places like China, where they've just done a massive TV rights deal for the first time for the National League. Chinese companies in sports marketing are becoming just about to become major players on the world stage. There are deals being done all the time. It's one of the key trends. So the trend of media rights is polarization. It's more for the big guys, less for everybody else. It makes it more difficult, if you're not one of those big sports, to find space on television in the schedules. And if you can get on, it certainly makes it difficult to earn any decent money. So you are left to try and make things work through selling the value of your exposure. And all this has been driven by market forces, and it differs from country to country. The impact of technology is having a role on that. In the UK, where I come from, the rights for the English Premier League have gone through the roof largely because BT, formerly the state telecoms provider, wants to sell more broadband subscriptions and decided the way to get in was to invest in sports rights. The competition that's created has absolutely ignited fire under the battle between Sky Sports and BT, and that sort of thing, the impact of particularly telecommunications companies coming into market and challenging established broadcasters for sports rights is sending things through the roof. Then there's the impact of corporate forces. Throughout Europe, the rights for the Olympic Games, for future editions, no longer are being sold directly to national broadcasters. They've all been sold to Discovery, the US Post Channel, which also owns Eurosport. It's a power play by a big US broadcaster, which is supplanting national broadcasters around Europe. Again, it's a major, major change in the environment, and it's a change which affects the ability to buy and sell rights and to develop new revenue streams from them. In sponsorship continues to grow ahead of the curve of advertising. We've heard for years that people are moving away from traditional advertising. There's some evidence to suggest that may not be happening quite as quickly as we thought. But what has changed is the idea that marketing is moving towards engagement and not interruption as a model. Interruption being the 30-second spot that comes on in the middle of your favorite television programs. It's more to do with building real relationships with consumers, and that's good news for sponsorship, and it's good news for sport. And one of the things which is clearance, which is liberating the skill, which is requiring this, is the role of online and social media, which makes everybody a publisher. Means nobody is any longer reliant for basic connectivity on a gatekeeper media. It means that you can find an audience and you can talk directly to them in a way that was never possible, certainly during the time that I was going on. It's about relationships which can be created a lot around the transaction, and partly relies on the fact that brand reputation is far more important than ever before. There's tons and tons of evidence out there that suggests that if a consumer's in a lot of different markets, if faced with two products which are ostensibly identical and similar price, and they deliver similar value to the consumer will be swayed by the reputation, what they know about a particular brand or company. And that companies are increasingly creating more positive reputations, bolstering their brand image through involvement with sports. So it's another major opportunity. The third of the revenue streams I'd just like to touch on is match day, and this is perhaps the most obvious one. Match day for whatever events, ticket sales still represent globally the biggest chunk of revenues from sport. But stadia are, by their very nature, restrictive. So the big challenge now for certainly the major sports events, the major sports franchise, is to go beyond the stadia. Of course, they're building bigger stadia. They're building stadia. Madrid want to move. Barcelona plans for a new stadium. And across Italy, they're bringing things up to line. And the key thing is to create premium facilities. It's fine to be able to sell somebody a seat, but increasingly we want to sell them an experience. And that means putting in a bunch of facilities that make the experience. That may be premium seats, it may be boxes, and it may be just doing something clever. One of the wackiest things that I've come across in recent years was the New York Mets baseball team. Now, baseball, they play a lot of games. I think the Mets have to sell, or have an inventory to sell each year, about 2.5 million seats. That's in New York, probably the most competitive sports market anywhere in the world. Bizarrely, probably outside of Melbourne in Australia. Now, for the Mets, that means that their marketing people have to be on their toes absolutely all the time. So some of them, or one of them, or one morning, you can almost imagine a Monday morning meeting and say, right, who's got a great idea? What are we going to do? How are we going to pack the ground for that fixture against the Dodgers or whoever next month? So somebody who's obviously had a heavy night, just sleeping over, trying to doze off a hangover or something, sticks their hands up at the end of the table and says, I know, let's get them to bring their pets and bring a dog to the game day. Did phenomenally well. It was a piece of ludicrous thinking, perhaps, but in retrospect, it's a genius. They turned up in their hundreds, if not thousands, with their dogs on leads. And there are pictures of these dogs wearing baseball caps and jumpers, this, that, and that. And because they know what they're doing, because they're really sharp marketers, the area of the stadium, which was put aside for people with their dogs, got its own sponsor, strangely enough, a dog food manufacturer. So it's a win-win. The people will. They didn't have to stay at home with their pets. The pets won. Not because they love baseball, but because they got free food. It's just great thinking. And it brought bums on seats. It sold those tickets. Elsewhere in the States, we're seeing stadiums being built in nightclubs, which actually run during the game, which possibly tells you something about the excitement level of certain American sports. And pools, you can watch sport as you paddle around in a pool during the fifth innings of a baseball game. Right. Now, as I said, all of this may not be, you may wonder why this is particularly relevant to you, and I'm wondering why my slide hasn't changed. This is, in many respects, a business unlike any other. The trick here is to make its aha. I have skipped ahead, but I'm way over time already, so let's go back. Sport is a business unlike any other, and it is a business unlike any other for a lot of reasons, but not least of all because it has a dimension that making ketchup, selling sausages, building sports cars doesn't have. And it's the social dimension. It's the element of it that means that sport is intrinsically linked with governments and government policies. Sport is important to education. People who are active, again, there's tons of research, are more retentive. Their academic performance among kids who are engaged in active sport is outperforms others. Sport teaches teamwork, endeavor, discipline. It's all about life skills. There are health benefits across society which saves ultimately government's money, and it's a great reason for governments to continue to either invest in or join in partnerships within sport. And sport is a great source of national pride. You only have to look at what happened in Singapore after its independence from the UK. Sport was seen as a way of creating a cohesive society out of a population drawn from so many different religions, nationalities, and backgrounds. And Singapore has gone on to become a role model of what is achievable. The opening last year and the year before of the new Singapore Sports Hub. I would suggest to you, again, scale is important, as an example of how you create, bit by bit, a business around sport. It's right up there with everything else that you might ever look at. There are, of course, the obstacles. Is this going to stay? It's a great big business, but there's massive polarization, not just between individual sports, but not everybody has got the critical mass in terms of population. Not everybody has big markets to develop domestic sport businesses which achieve the sort of figures that we've been talking about. But it's all about scale, and it's all about ambition. You set objectives accordingly. There's intense competition to host events which are generators of revenue. And I touched on this earlier, it's the problem around the world of the globalization of domestic sports. The popularity of the English Premier League, particularly in Southeast Asia, is great news for the English Premier League, but not if you're running the Malaysian Football Association. It's a real problem. They don't think the colonial era ever went away in places like Malaysia, because when they look down the street and 6 out of every 10 youngsters who's wearing a t-shirt is in the colours of Manchester United or Arsenal, they can't name a single player from their own national team. That's a problem that they have to deal with. Lack of markets can, of course, hinder growth, or is a barrier to growth. But as important as any of this, is what we find around the world, poor standards of governance and professionalism, because, and I'm not contradicting myself here, sport may be a love thing, but just because it's a love thing doesn't mean that it can't also be a professional business. I'd like to just wrap up by introducing you to somebody Patrick Nally is a guy who is often known as the father, or one of the fathers of sports marketing, who developed the blueprint for marketing and sales rights around major events, which is pretty much the way that things have been done ever since the mid-80s. But he believes that it's time to change. He says the way that sports centers are operated for 40, 50 years is not necessarily the model. We need to change, try and find a new way forward. And everybody with an interest should be part of that conversation. And really, that's what we're here for today. It's to get that conversation started. You all have an interest in it. I'm going to be back at about 2 o'clock this afternoon, having listened to your contributions and the contributions of the other speakers. And I'll be delighted to work with you in a great conversation again, to see how the things that we've heard today might start to be filtered into ideas which may lead to policies, which may give inspiration to make a change to the way that the sports business is seen here in Trinidad. Because what NALI actually means in looking to do things in new ways is about redefining stuff. It's redefining things like sponsorship all about. It's about applying professional skills. It's about adopting an entrepreneurial approach to creating new relationships between all the stakeholders in sport. And in particular, it's about using new technologies to create new areas of connectivity to link all the stakeholders in sport. It's about new thinking for new times. But that said, new thinking, you mustn't ever forget the luck. Look, you actually scored a goal. It doesn't happen very often. Thanks very much for your attention. And it's my great pleasure now to introduce the next speaker to you, your Minister for Sport and Youth Affairs, Mr. Dal Smith.
Thank you, Mr. Roberts. Sure. Kevin Roberts, that is. Welcome to Trinidad and Tobago, and thanks for a fantastic presentation. Good morning, everyone. I always like to acknowledge royalty. I think he may have gone to the restroom, Mr. Daisy Crawford. I want to thank Mr. Lewis for inviting me here this morning, and I apologize for coming out late. I've seen residents this morning in the constituency since 5 o'clock. I'm really good. I'd like to start out in the way. But again, thank you for having me here. What I've seen so far, I've heard from Mr. Sarat, and when I look around the room, I see a number of familiar faces in the sporting fraternity. I'd just like to thank you all for having a full house in sport. It shows that in it, I really love what Trinidad and Tobago has to offer with regards to the sport, and I have to always include the word and the keyword youth, because we are now the Ministry of Sport and Youth Affairs again. And especially, I acknowledge the chairman for the sport company, Mr. Michael Phillip, and I also see a number of major corporate entities here, which is always good to see, and I want to thank you all for attending here for this fantastic initiative. I see a number of presidents, athletes, for different NGBs who have had the opportunity to meet with very early in my tenure. It's one of the first things that I ensure to do, our team ensure to do with regards to consultation, to ensure that the ivory tower that has been the norm in sport, we chip away of that and we have a more we and us working together. But a number of, Mr. Crawford, welcome back. Out of this, I acknowledge you. A number of key points came out in both presentations, and I'll be short. I'll just touch on a few with regards to the ministry's vision moving forward, or what we have inherited and how we move forward. We've heard Mr. Sarah talk about sports tourism, and he would have said something that I've been echoing from day one. It's a cool buzzword. This very building that we're in, skyline has changed in the past few years. And the whole mission behind that was the Vision 2020 plan from a former government to make Trinidad and tell us extent to be, which I'll talk about in a while, the financial capital for the Caribbean. But that was a form of tourism to bring in various international companies and so on, have investment and have Trinidad bustling and busting. A number of these buildings still undone. A number of these buildings are still empty. You would have seen earlier in this fiscal year, I was watching the news and I saw there was a gentleman who came down and was discussing tourism in Trinidad to be similar to Mr. Roberts, an expert internationally. And he said for the first time, we should market and advertise Trinidad and Tobago separate. I don't know how much of you saw that, but Tobago is a completely different market with regards to leisure and beauty and stuff from Trinidad. Trinidad aspect of it is more industrial and business. For the first time in my life, I've heard somebody ever spoken to that capacity, which makes sense. But the point where I'm trying to get at with those two concepts is exactly that. A number of times we tend to put the cart before the horse. Case in point, these buildings here. Case in point, even the three nationals that Mr. Roberts and Mr. Serrato have spoken about, the aquatic, the cycling, and the tennis, which are three state-of-the-art facilities. I mean, they're really beautiful, and when you look at it, and we're still finalizing as well, although finishing takes a lot of money and a lot of time, and that's what we're finalizing now. But in hindsight, would they really necessary? You know, a lot of governing bodies, when I meet and speak to them, most of them want a home. And it's fine to have a home. But again, putting the car before the horse, should we look at maybe having bedrooms throughout Trinidad and Tobago rather than having one centralized location that costs of millions of dollars with regards to one location? Right? I go out on a daily basis with members of parliament, councillors, chairmen of different corporations. And of course, there's no doubt that grounds and pavilions and facilities are a key part of all communities. And I go around with these gentlemen and females and so on, and some of these parks and facilities, just this week, Monday, 3 minutes between our bomb them. You can throw a stone into the other one. And I mean, it's no doubt, I know sports is very competitive. All of us in here, probably paid or involved in sport, we're very competitive. And I saw that competitiveness when I met with all the governing bodies, when it comes to the bat and fight for their brand, fight for the sport, which is fine. But does it make sense? And that comes back to points that came up in the two other presentations, which I've been singing since I came in, is data collection and analyzing of data. Because I personally don't think any politician or any chairman or president of any sporting body should have to make decisions. Data and proper data analysis should be making the decisions for us, and that will make Trinidad and Tobago and our job much easier. But by the time you have the absence of that, creeps in the corruption, the favoritism, the parties, the religion, and all the other aspects that makes the line from point A to B deviate and makes things messy. In a former job that I had, I worked at a company called GTEC, which is Playway Lotto Cash Board. My background is advertising and marketing. I have a bachelor's and master's in both. So I can relate to what this seminar is about. I see a number of colleagues that I work with in that industry. And while at GTEC, data was the way that we move forward with regards to everything, gaming industry and stuff. We knew certain locations, geography, races, ages, where's the best place to put machines, what kind of games to come up with. Nothing was done just on a hitch. Done based on data. But the other thing that I came out with regards to the presentation is the decision making that went on in the boardrooms at that company with regards to being a corporate citizen and supporting different aspects of Trinidad and Tobago. And there's always a decision. I mean, in the ministry in itself, on any given day, we'll get thousands of letters for sponsorship. Same thing happened in the private sector. And I was on the team of the sponsorship team at that time. And we'll always have four or five categories. We'll have green, elderly, we'll have sport, we have youth, we'll have a couple others, disabled and so on. And we'll have a pot of money, just like a number of these organizations that are here, how to divvy up, and we'll go through the letters and so on and decide what to go with regards to sponsorship and so on. And even back then, we had difficulties with regards to how we work with sport because of the decibel of, arguing in the public and to extend corruption that was going on in sport. That a number of the brands would have wanted to pull their way away from that and go to other avenues. And I want to thank the brands and the companies and the organizations that have steady course and stayed with sport for the love of sport and knowing what it could do for the country on a whole. But the sports tourism aspect of it is selling Trinidad and Tobago outside of Trinidad and Tobago. How can we even look at that if we can't even sell ourselves to ourselves? How can we look to sell Trinidad and Tobago as a sporting world, a sporting hub, if we even sell to our own people on the grassroots level? I'm making sense, you understand what I'm saying? Because it's a hard sell, and it's a hard sell for a number of reasons. Part of it starts with me. Getting the accepted the job as the Minister of Sport, to set the example, to remain humble, to stay grounded, to ensure that we don't have corruption. When I met with all the governing bodies, I asked the same question to all of them. And the number one issue and problem was that. Was the issues with mismanagement of funds and so on. So, not just at my level, but we are in a process now in the ministry to ensure that the ministry cleans up its act and put policies in place so we can set the example and it can be ushered out as a team with regards to all the governing bodies that we can move forward and clean up sport in Trinidad and Tobago so we can sell it to the people of Trinidad and Tobago first before we move on. You know, when I was the chairman of the Diego Martin Regional Corporation, I was there for a few years, 2 years. And again, you want to do as much in that period of time. And I just narrowed it down to two or three issues. There were a number of issues that people had. And the main problem in Diego Martin is Mexico was flooding. And I took that bull by the horn. And so far, I mean, not to boast about a number of people worked. And we had consultation and we worked with other organizations and put together. And we was able to diffuse that for now so far. And it's the same thing that we're trying to do in sport. The number one issue that keeps coming out is that corruption and mismanagement and so on. So with your help, with the help of my chairman and the rest of the team, that we hope that we can really simmer that down and get that aspect. Because before we jump out and start to try to push these things, there are a lot of things that we have to do in the market that may jeopardize and hinder us moving forward. Until we take care of our business inside, all of us collectively together, then and only then that we really have an effort and strive to move forward with some of the things that we're hearing. I mean, look how much data Mr. Roberts was able to give us this morning. Basic data, even in the ministry, we are unable to get. Basic figures, I mean, benchmarking. Okay, we're here this year, we achieved these things this year. Where are we planning to go next year? Just to get where we at. When I met with a number of the governing bodies as well, they need to have benchmarks. And not much, 5 or 6 benchmarks that you achieved in the last 5 years or last year. So you can see, increasing females, increasing age groups, increasing in a geographic location, and so on, to have that data to move forward. We have to get there. And another major thing that we are looking at came up as well, Mr. Sarah's presentation was, he was absolutely right when he said, disjointedness with regards to the different ministries and different organizations. I was blown away when I met with the Minister of Culture and the Minister of Education to hear that they also have sporting departments and sporting bodies doing almost the same thing we're doing and we have never met. So here we are, sport, all the other ministries. I mean, there's no fault of anybody's not here to politicize. It is what it is with the oil price. It's the first time I've ever done a budget in pencil. So every day literally have to be rubbing off and changing. But again, we're dealing with it, we're moving forward. But there are people in all different sections doing and fighting for the same resources to get our minds, our hearts, and of course the bamboos together so we can propel and move forward with 3 or 4 or 5 things. But that is something that we're working on. Mr. Garcia and I have been having fantastic discussions so far, not only with UTT, with UB, but more so with the primary and the secondary schools, because again, benchmarking is something that the chairman and I are trying to do. And so far what we've been seeing, the models of success seem to be in terms of development in Australia, Cuba, and to our colleagues in Jamaica. They're obviously doing something right. And we're looking at benchmarking and seeing what they're doing in those countries to see how we can try and tailor to our success here in Trinidad and Tobago. Even culture, the Ministry of Culture and us are going to be teaming up again to bring back, as we said in our manifesto, that we really want to be pumping at the grassroots level, what Jamaica does, what Australia does, what Cuba does. Far more the pyramid, we want to turn the pyramid on its head and focus on the young kids in terms of development, giving them the opportunity to play, but more importantly, giving them the opportunity to play a more wider variety of sports. I mean, right now, the figure that we blasted his $1.5 trillion in terms of sport. When I ask for figures and so on in Trinidad, there are no figures. When I speak to our facilities managers, they may be able to see where Carnival Time made a $1.2 million in revenue and stuff, but really and truly, there's no data, there's no information. Even when you ask the different sporting organizations in terms of revenue, and it's very difficult to get that. So just starting off with that, it's difficult to benchmark and gauge in terms of the financial aspect and the profit, if there's any at all, in terms of money coming in. Right, so we're here to work together with the ministry. We're a listening ministry this time around. We're here to listen. We're here to work with you all. I think we have a good team. I think we want a good thing. And as I said, we're trying to put that aspect behind us with the corruption and the mismanagement. Now we have to propel and move forward with one plan together, get Trinidad to be on the map. Even the three national centers that he spoke about, if you ask me, have a different debate if it was necessary, but it's there and it is what it is. Even the planning in terms of programs, but there's no way you're going to fill up that cycling track every weekend. There's no way you're going to have that tennis center full to capacity every weekend. We know that, just like the other stadium that we have now. And that is the problem, because every politician that comes in, because there's no data to guide them. Infrastructure and development is the way forward to leave a legacy. I build that. As me who build that. I could be passing through this 5 year till we're not building anything, finishing what we have, maintaining what we have, and let the development fund pump into the young people of Trinidad and Tobago. Another thing I want to talk to with regards to the sponsors. I know it's a very tedious task to get that sponsorship. I know it's 150% that you get back with regards to that, and it's like an encyclopedia you have to fill out, and it takes a little while. So it's something I'm having a discussion with the Ministry of Finance, that process a little easier. And also for the refunds to come back a little quicker. But more importantly, for the regular layman on the street to be able to donate and assist and sponsor and donate from your ATM card and stuff to various sports, and being able to get a tax break with regards to that as well. The number of people have been asking how to get money to Cleopatra or to Andrew Lewis, to St. Philip and so on. So we need to have easier access to the public to be able to donate as well, so we can have the funding, because they'll always have a gap. When I ask each governing body how much they ask for and how much they receive, there's always a 200%, 300% difference between what they receive from the ministry and what they ask for. So we have to find clever, new, innovative ways to bridge that gap. Even in terms of the facilities as well, we also want to ensure that the politics is kept out of it, where we're going to ensure that we have naming rights for brands. So you may have a pool or tennis court named after a national athlete, but the actual entire facility, just like what is done in models in other first world countries, we're going to ensure that we have brand-sponsored naming rights. And if the brand is a drink or a beverage or whatever, they get the exclusive rights for this. So that is something that we're looking at as well. Staffing of those locations are key. Again, we want to work with all the governing bodies. For the first time, we included all the governing bodies with regards to being part of the consultation to move forward with those national centers. And of course, they'll have a say with regards to the staffing and move forward. But we don't want those national centers to what happened in Napa. I mean, they're very beautiful buildings, they're unique buildings, they're different buildings. The aquatic center, it was all done by Shanghai. Unfortunately, somebody didn't have the common sense to ensure that we had OGTs or young engineers involved in that process to learn the entire maintenance of it. So again, all those things were foregone to speed up the production. We also have to ensure that we have the proper staff, the proper maintenance, so these buildings could running. The cycling track, case in point, the air conditioning system could never be turned off at its own power plant. For all three of the buildings there, there's a amusement park, for those who don't know, a water park at that venue. So there's a lot of things that we have to ensure that we keep it up on. But overall, we're here to work with you all, remain humble, remain listening. My doors are always open. Take what you learned today and let's try and work to ensure that Trinidad to be able to move forward. Sell sport in Trinidad first. Let's clean up the act here. Let's vent our dirty linen internally. So the sponsors that are here, you see just the athletes and the athletes alone, not the minister, not the presidents, not the parents, not the coaches. Let it be about the athletes. Let the athletes be the stars. Let them shine. And I think we want to have the thing from there. So God bless you all. Enjoy the rest of the day. And thank you.
Partly to my, my verbosity and enjoying it so much, we're hugely over time. So part of today is about interaction, and a big part of today is about interaction. So we'd just like to give you the opportunity, to go to our coffee break, to ask the Minister, Mr. President, very short, but let's take two or three. Mr. Lewis is waving his arm at the back of the message box. Okay. It's, when people are doing that, they're usually making a different kind of gesture in my direction. I'm kind of used to it. Okay. Right. So, ladies and gentlemen, if you have a question, either for the minister, for the president of athletics, or for myself, please raise your hand. We'll get a microphone over to you. Tell us who you are. I've got a lady right down at the front to go up. And if you could address your question to which member.
What resonated with me, and I'm so happy to hear from all of you, is the focus on data. And how so many of us in the sporting bodies do a lot of things that are more subjective and not very relying on really hard data. So my question now is that we received requests to provide some kinds of data. You know us, but maybe for chess, maybe like you, Mr. Sir, you have maybe more resources. But how is the ministry going to assist us? Because for me as president, data is very important. How are you going to help us develop the kind of infrastructure that we need? Because you know we are all volunteers, we have other jobs and so on. To focus on getting this kind of data that we need, which is critical for us to really move on the sports. What kind of support would we be providing?
All right, well, that's okay. We are right now. Ministry might be more backward than most of us regards to data and information. So we have to get our back. I mean, I asked certain things with regards to size of grounds, how many grounds are pitches, how many grounds are nets. But what happens is a number of these facilities aren't fully open for a couple of months, culture, schools, and so on. So right now we're doing an overall inventory of all the facilities that we have, size, specs, location, and the other number. We have a map and you can set up on the website where you can click at any time and see which grounds you can play cricket, what events are going on and stuff. So we are doing a number of stuff on our end, but we are forming a department right now. That is our first main goal that we're doing, and of course we're going to be filtering it out to move the money. Yeah,
thank you.
Setting up that website back in 2010, that was the intention. So we have a lot of the information there, and as I indicated, because of what I do, I'm very data driven, and you know, I take it personally. So we don't have the resources, at least not yet.
Gentlemen, is there a case to be for a central plan, right? Phrase to roll out a system which is common and shared by various sports bodies, so that we don't go out and one group comes up with one system, framework and the other, so that everything's shareable and comparable. Is that the objective?
Yeah, the plan is to have a software system that will be given out to all the government body and a set of system that daily will be put on and filter and put on to the set. Again, when these experts come in and go higher, that will be top priority. That whole government body. Similar to maintenance. Then we want to ensure that 3-4 months after the tender and get things done. So those are the two packages that we're going to see. And we're going to be needing the government bodies, the assistance, and we're going to be maintenance. But if you see anything that needs changing or repair, you can also create that as the NGP and the assistance with regards to that and the administrators.
I also think that the move to have essential
okay, thank you for that. Do we have another, just a couple of questions? Pointed initially in the direction of somebody right at the back, who I can't quite see, and then we'll come further forward and take your question afterwards. Okay.
Hello,
that really is a question that's being discussed. I had that discussion in Lagos, Nigeria, last year. I had that discussion in Singapore, in Malaysia, and in the Gulf, in Qatar, where generally they can do what they like and spend as much money as they like to sort problems out. But it goes beyond drain of money. I would think that in the long term, the best thing to do is to try and harness the energy that's created around those needs by creating partnerships with individual clubs. They are a fact of life, and the impact that they have on society can perhaps be celebrated for what it's worth, but to make sure that the people that are engaged with those leagues are made at all times aware that there are local alternatives. So use the English Premier League and Serie A as an inspiration to get more kids actually out there playing structured football, to funnel them in. So talking about the need to get this pyramid sorted out. We're getting young people playing a lot of sports. So in the same way as I would say the same thing about the Olympic Games, so use the inspiration. These leagues are some of the best in the world. They've got the best players in the world. Use the inspiration to move people into sport. And as it grows from the base, there's an opportunity to raise levels in domestic games, domestic clubs, domestic leagues. It's not, there's no quick fix. I wish it's something you put together, and I feel quite strong. There is absolutely no purpose. As long as the people look for TV to spend millions and millions of dollars to bring English Premier League, Spanish football, and other leagues into this country and to others around the world, it's a fact of life. There's no silver bullet. So if redirect people to activity nationally. I mean, it doesn't sound too simplistic, but there isn't a simple answer. What's great, I suppose, though, is if you return the clock back a little bit and have a Dwight York in the Premier League every year, so that you have national icons play, whether it's in the Premier League or anywhere else, having national icons is always inspirational. Question from Jeff Lazar. My name
is Rishi Penny. I'm a ground racer. I was a 2020. My question has to do with transparency and governance, especially when it comes to the national governing body, governing various aspects of motorsport. Motorsport and all other sports. In my opinion, I believe that motorsport has two of the largest spectator audience in China today after football and cricket. Just recently, there was a night rides, it's completely packed on the road. And you ask promoters, you ask the and you think about governing body, you know, about these, they're not profitable. You know, they're picking at a loss. So, my question has to do with transparency and governance, so that real aspect of the sport can be better. You know, getting our athletes and our sportsmen the right support so that they can take it to the next level.
So, as it sounds like it's possibly one for you, and obviously, governance is such a huge issue. What across the world?
Well, once you talk about transparency and accountability, and as I indicated in my presentation, that's one of the challenges. Indicated that motorsport is integral to its best functioning facilitator. He said, packs of people, I need numbers, how many people in the course. And these are the things, you know, we just screw these things and we estimate that it's about some of the people. I can say that for our championships, in the Olympic year, with championship year, we have close to about 10,000 people in the stadium for our championships. Just over $150,000 in terms of fees. We have that data. And the thing about it is, even the same before, I think back in the 80s, we had a league, I don't remember the name now, but we had more community based teams. Strikers, so you had that community base, and they were coming up to support, and they had a brand. So you had the Southern brand, you had the Central brand, and the East brand. So that, you know, those are the things that we need to build on, but I felt, because, you know, they were building in the community. Even when we look at what happens in the primary school, the secondary school, general school level, build it from the community. There are governments and ministers there, all throughout Trinidad and Tobago, but schools prefer to go to the stadium and school sports. Stay in the community, more people will probably support and then they will entrepreneurs with a different thing, benefit as opposed to going to the stadium. These are the things we need to look at.
And Minister, on that topic of transparency and governance, does the government take the lead? Should the government take the lead? And as you hold at least some of the skills, is there an active by developing a blueprint for good governance, some sort of damage with potentially drawing funds for those organizations which do not adhere to best practice.
We are accustomed to the minister jumping into the business of the company bodies. My mantra is the stars that are struggling. We already had some consumer fee in the school, and just want to give her that opportunity. serve you, tackle for a period of time, take up your pride, and forget the personal aspect of it. So be active, keep a background, shout out to resources and so on.
Okay, so somebody actually has his hands on the mic.
I don't mind taking a few more questions. I really like it. So let's take a look.
All right, okay.
Thank you. I could be a joint coffee.
We have to finish before midnight.
But again, this is the sort of what we want to hear, some of the concerns and stuff.
Okay, so we have a question back, and we will get to you in the chat. Please go ahead.
Good morning, everybody. James Saunders, sport broadcaster, media communications consultant. Now, Mr. Serrati tickled some very interesting points. Among them, of course, a lack of data, as was mentioned earlier. He also spoke about structuralizing the different processes and also finding a proper measuring stick for success from implementation to end result, be it financial or otherwise. What do you propose? Because it seems to be something that's resting heavily in the chest. What do you propose? Or are you suggesting maybe that there should be some sort of overseeing committee or body responsible for ensuring that we have what you're proposing?
Well, I am saying that the minister is addressing that where they facilitate that kind of resources or training for the federation so that they can have these things in place. Measurement thing is very important. We tend when we're looking at numbers, okay, if I look at our federation, some of the targets or the information we require is how many goals, how many medals we're going to win at the Olympics. And I don't think that should be the question. That should not be the question. As I indicated previously, you cannot buy them. You have to strategize and plan how we get there. Well, yes. But the thing is understanding the whole thing. And I can speak in the track and field. The last world championships, Trinidad and Tobago was in the top 50 on the medal table at the last world championships, ahead of countries with bigger, larger populations and those kind of things. We tend not to look at that. We look at and we have to move beyond that. Where are we in comparison to the Western world and those things? I often get into arguments at sport when they ask me how much medals you get to lifter and how much medals you get in the picks, and I ask them, once you can tell me the football tournament, how many goals they will score, and you can see how many ones they will score in the game, I will tell them how many medals I will get. So I think the whole measurement system, and that's when I indicated just now, across the board, sports, we have to understand what are the outcomes, not the outputs. We have to understand the outcomes. The growth, as the minister indicated, the participation, right now we see the fall of a female in sport, what is needed to be done to keep females in the sport, and what we are doing to get those numbers back. So those are the kind of measurement things that I'm saying. And we have to look at it in its totality across the entire scheme of
there's a chap down here whose hand's been up almost since we started. And I think we really ought to give him the mic. Give him the platform.
Thank you very much, Tyrone Marcus, Ministry of Sport. Question to Mr. Roberts. There's always controversy and scandal in sport, and I was really wondering how much weight commercial entities give to maintaining their brand, because sometimes you see an inconsistent response of sponsors when scandal breaks out. So we've had the issues with Russia, the IAA, for instance, and we're not sure whether Adidas has pulled out or not. There seems to be a conversation happening at the global level. Then Nike, for instance, has responded very quickly with Maria Sharapova, but didn't seem to respond that quickly with Tiger Woods. So we're a little bit confused and wondering, okay, is it that once there's controversy, sponsors say, I'm staying far, because that's something that we can't get away from. And so what's the hope for Trinidad and Tobago when there is a controversy?
Well, I think that the key thing here, we've seen a change in the last 12 months, an obvious change to the way that brands respond to these sort of issues. If you remember, when FIFA blew up, who told the world that they were simply coming to the end of their contracts and probably weren't going to renew. So there was no real way of linking that to the scandal. But the difference seems to be like if you do the Salt Lake City games, where I think we've forgotten how serious that was at the time, where members of the Salt Lake bidding team had effectively been bribing members of the International Olympic Committee with school fees, with coats, with all sorts of business, vote to take the games to somewhere. Not one sport in the day moved out because of that. And all the research that was done by the IOC after that suggested that the public was able to see beyond the International Olympic Committee to the Olympic Games. The issue being, the public was not that concerned about a bunch of middle-aged men in suits and what they do or how they behave, as long as they can believe in the Olympic Games themselves and what they score on the track and in the sports. Then no damage, there may be some reputational damage to the IOC, but not cares about the, say, who really is a fan, as a consumer, cares about FIFA. About the sport and what happens on the field. But the difference is, those scandals, such as that which has hit athletics with regards to what's happening in Russia and elsewhere, is with the fee that the scandal does affect what happens on the field. That's when the public starts to lose faith in the sport. There is no point in sport if what is a fan. If what you're watching is a foregone conclusion, the whole thing becomes, it is devalued entirely. Now, the public knows that they're far more upset about doping in athletics and doping match fixing in sports than they are about bribery and corruption within governing bodies. And I think brands are wising up to that. So as soon as they see an athlete who is involved in something which could affect the outcome of the sport itself, they're starting to It was less than 24 hours in the case of Sharapova, which is kind of impressive, and tells you, I think, how far forward the corporate response and the corporate empathy with what's happening in school has developed over the last couple of years. I think the same is true worldwide. Corporations are bothered about stuff. The of the sport, not so much criminal behaviour by the people in government bodies, because the public, to be honest, is not that concerned. Okay. One final question? Two final questions.
Good morning. This is for you. Minister of Sport, coaching Ministry of Sport. Talk about the implications in terms of sport and education in sport, because I know myself in sport, that has been one of the major issues I think in terms of when it comes to funding.
bodies. And I would like to find out from you, sir, if and when or how soon the possibilities in terms of this area, is there any plans to deal with this duplication that we have that exists now? Because I think in terms of the necessary funding, it means as I said, duplicated in so many ways, because I would do tennis and I would go to a venue to do tennis and I would hear the Ministry of Education is doing the same, but they know that the sport is also coming. They would say that sport is also doing a camp. So the funding itself is not evenly distributed, but effectively distributed. And I'll take a look at
that.
One of
the issues that is already coming. Right to a number of organizations for families, for staying, which is fine. Some people do it, you shoot that goal 10 times, you must score once, right? You shoot once and you miss out to the game. Some people do it with all the retention. Right? Some people make a living off it. I'm starting to see some of the players' names, those people from what has happened to happen. I'm joking, you go right to other ministries as well. They get funding, so they're now actually Ministry of Finance is setting up a system where we can put all forms of requests for funding into a database like site classic and it's a deal too, that they will come up and pop up. So the name of the person, the name of the foundation, score the amount. I could just click on putting that person in the draft and see if they want to go from school. Well, understand that? So that's a system again that we look into. The other aspect with regards to the application of that they would support as they would in culture, education as well. Even to the local government as well, have people who do that. So we all have the pockets of money to do something. So we're trying to have a synergy of all those organizations. And what is key is, and I think that's what the ministry got into problems with when we went into the whole life sport with trying to educate all this. Our core competency is sport, not education. Ministry of Education core competency is education. Culture is culture. That's why I was saying, it starts to be a strong man, but in the peace. So now, conversation is coming out. Culture is important for the Olympics. We need to compete with our own people. Village Olympics is about culture. Village Olympics is sports. It's under culture, so we have taken over that from even primary school. All the government bodies know that part of the criteria that asked for who are not in the primary school to get in the primary school. But what we're finding is not everybody can play football, not everybody can play cricket or tennis. I went up, and don't laugh at this, I don't know how much of you were upbeat. I went up, you know, all fours it? Have you all ever been to all fours tournament? Let me tell you something. I went to all fours tournament 2 weeks ago in St. John. The top prize was $150,000 for 2 days at training. It was $5,000 a team of four, and they were turning away people. Teams from Boston, from Canada, lining up uniformly for something well organized. So my point is, we want to encourage as much opportunity and options for young people to play. My son, I mean, 100 pounds away from football for training. I would have never dreamed in my life my son would have played tennis. I never played tennis in my life, but because I gave him the opportunity to play and try it, and he shined and he loves it. That's what we want to have across the board. First time we're going to be pushing to ensure that we have Easter camp for the kids again. We will be doing Ministry of Education and summer camp for kids. So we will be pumping it up and we might even encourage a Christmas camp depending on the funds. At the grassroots at the primary school and the grassroots level, even the pro league, they're not like a we're bringing it up. Which marvels in they will Martin not to have a there'll be a popscotch in Hickshead in Carinage, 1,000 people come. And we would take a stadium and you can't play on that sound too. So we have to go back in the grounds. I saw it in my campaign. You know, we have to print t-shirts for the election campaign. And I was like, you know what? Let me mark in the background. Let's change up things a little bit. 10 districts in the Martin Central. I printed each district name on the t-shirt. Ravi Road. knows when that factor, because exactly what you talk about, people want to identify where they're from, the location and the community. T-shirt sales and merchandise items as well. Those are clear indicators that people want to have things in the community. They want location, they want to have one voice, and that's what we plan. So we plan to
say this.
That's why we make ourselves individually careful. And we have expanded the number of sports that we're doing as well. And we make ourselves individually for the station that we have involved.
So we see this thing in the end of the camp. We have over 20,000 children benefited from the camp. And it's a concern for football.
No, you're right. It's a strange thing to say that one of the things that I asked you, for obvious reason, the camp was stopped for 2 years. And we get to the point. But I asked him, okay, so we had this summer. I remember when I was a young boy. But I actually think in terms of years that we didn't have the teenage pregnancy war, the crime war, where they won medals, and there was no data or no caption with regards to that. We were the days when we got big bodies, but that's what Jamaica does. They have these camps, they go into the grassroots and they identify talent and they put them out there. But more importantly, we want to make sure that the kids have something to do. Yes, it's a matter of something because they're getting in a lot of trouble compared to our time. But also, to get the physical, the Easter camp is to build the technique and the motion and mobility and so on. Different aspects of that.
Okay, now, I think I know something about that too.
Yeah.
I think I know what that means. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for your questions this morning. We have to move on. It's been absolutely fascinating, but we're a long way over time right now. We're going to take a coffee break for 10 minutes, but before we do that, could you please join me in thanking Minister Darren Smith and Mr.